Hi people from the 21st century. Actually, I'm so glad that you turn up. I love to make this project, so I hope that you stay around. I'm so thankful that you keep on subscribing and staying around on the channel. The first company bearing the name White Star Line was found in Liverpool, England, by John P. Clinton and Henry Wilson in 1845. It focused on the UK-Australia trade. The fleet initially consisted of 10 ships, RMS Taylor, Blue Jacket, White Star, Red Jacket, Allen, Ben, Nevis, Emma, Mermaid, and Iowa. Taylor was the largest ship of its day, but wrecked on his maiden voyage to Australia, a disaster that haunted the company for years. The original White Star merged with two other smaller lines. In 1864, the Black Line and the Eagle Line, White Star concentrated on Liverpool to New York City services. Heavy investment in new ships was financed by borrowing, but the company's bank, the Royal Bank of Liverpool, failed in October 1867. White Star was left with an incredible debt and was forced into bankruptcy. On January 1868, Thomas Smee, a director of the National Line, purchased the house flag, name trade and goodwill of the bankrupt company for £1,000. Then Smee was approached by Gustav Christian Snoff, a prominent Liverpool merchant, and his nephew, the shipbuilder Gustav Wilhelm Wolff. They offered to finance the new line if Smee had his ships built by Wolff's company, Harland and Wolff. Smee agreed, and a partnership with Harland and Wolff was established. Shipbuilders received their first orders on the 30th of July 1869. Then White Star began its North Atlantic run between Liverpool and New York with six nearly identical ships: the Oceanic, Atlantic, Baltic, Republic, slightly larger, Celtic and Adriatic. It was within the circle of the massive tides of immigrants from Europe to North America. The first substantial loss for the company came only 4 years after its founding, occurring the 31 of March 1873 with the sinking of the RMS Atlantic. In the wake of the Atlantic disaster, White Star ordered two new streamers from Harland and Wolff. The Germanic captured the westbound record first in August 1875, captured the eastbound record in February 1876, while the Britannic captured both records within less than 2 months of each other, beating the westbound record in November and the eastbound record in December. Germanic captured the westbound record for the last time in April 1877. Over the next 12 years, White Star expanded their services with the introduction of several cargo and livestock carriers on the North Atlantic, as well as established a small but lucrative passenger and cargo service to New Zealand. In an effort to outdo their competition, White Star began making plans to put two new liners into services. In order to build these new ships, Thomas Smee made arrangement with the British government for financial support. The two new ships could also be designed as armored merchant cruisers, which could be requisitioned by the British Navy in times of war. One notable development associated with the introduction of these two new ships was that they were the first White Star liners to incorporate the three-class passenger system. Beginning in the late 1890s, White Star experienced an explosion of rapid growth and expansion of its services, highlighted by a dramatic shift in focus from building the fastest ships on the North Atlantic to build the most comfortable and luxurious. The first step in this direction came in 1897 during the construction of a new ship, Cymru. Smee and his partners at Harland & Wolff set out to design two new liners for the North Atlantic run. The new steamers, which were intended to be named Oceanic and Olympic, were designed to be both the largest and luxurious the world had ever seen. But most immediately, problems arose because the shipbuilder had never constructed a vessel of this size. The health of Thomas Smee began to decline so rapidly that in fact managers with the White Star and Harland & Wolff both decided to cancel plans to construct the Olympic. The name was set, only to be reused 12 years later. His health improved for a brief time, allowing him to visit the Oceanic upon her completion in Belfast that July. Thomas died on 23 of November 1899 at the age of 62. In the immediate aftermath, control of the company was passed to Thomas' son. In September 1898, before his health began failing, Thomas Smee negotiated the terms for the orders of the last passenger line. As White Star gradually brought the Big Four into service, they also obtained several small intermediate liners in preparation for a considerable expansion of their passenger services on the North Atlantic in 1903. Along they came to obtain 5 new liners, beginning with the Arabic. In addition to the acquisition of these ships, White Star also acquired control of the routes as well. The Cunard Line was achieved to competition to the White Star. In response to Cunard's Lusitania and Mauretania, White Star ordered the Olympic class line, Olympic, Titanic and Britannic. While Cunard was famed for the speed of the ships, Olympic class dared to be the largest and most luxurious ship in the world. Olympic, however, was the only ship of its class to have a successful career. Titanic sank on her maiden voyage in April 1912, while Britannic was requisitioned by the British government while she was still being fitted out, and was used as a hospital ship during the Great War. Britannic hit an underwater mine. Like many other ship liners, White Star Line suffered heavy losses during the First World War, which began in August 1914. Including some of their most prestigious vessels, the first major war loss was the RMS Oceanic 1899, which was converted into an armamentar cruiser and ran aground near the Shetland Island. 1916 will see the largest loss of the war, Titanic sister ship Britannic, which was sunk after the striking of an naval mine. While in service as a hospital ship, many White Star vessels were requisitioned for various types of war services, most commonly used as a drop ship. The most notable vessel of these ships was the RMS Olympic, which transported over 200,000 troops during the conflict. The losses of the Britannic and Britannic left the Olympic as the only surviving member of the White Star. In 1922, White Star Line obtained 2 former German liners, which had been ceded to Britain as war reparation under the terms of the Treaty of Versailles. Post-war period, there was a boom in the transatlantic emigrant trade, from which White Star was able to benefit for a time. In 1927, the White Star Line was purchased by the Royal Mail Steam Packet Company, becoming the largest shipping group in the world. In 1933, because of the Great Depression, the British government agreed to provide assistance to the White Star and Cunard, on the condition that they merged on North Atlantic operation. The merger took place on the 10th of May 1934, creating the Cunard White Star Limited. Olympic, the last of her class, was removed from service. She was scrapped in 1937. In 1947, Cunard ended buying the part of Cunard White Star that they did not own, and revert to using the name Cunard on the 1st of January 1950. But from 1915, even the Georgic and Britannic, the last surviving White Star lines, flew the Cunard House flag above the White Star until they were each withdrawn from service. In 1956 and 1961, respectively, the retirement of the Britannic had marked the end of an era for the White Star as a visible brand.